So the plan of this lecture is to give a microscopical counting for the entropy of ADS4 black hole. I have notes. I was planning to put them in tech, but I was too lazy. So at the moment, there is only an handwritten copy that at a certain point, once I have corrected all the mistakes, I will put on the on the web, and maybe later on I will write some the same thing in LaTeX. I hope what you find is readable. And the plan of the lectures is the following. Thanks to Stefan, we already have a lot of background on black holes. But nevertheless, in the first of these lectures, I will discuss the black hole of interest, those that have an embedding, and I will give you some details on the object, and then we will study from the point of view of field theory. So the plan of the first lecture is to interpret this black hole using holography and to tell you what I have to compute. I'll try to be slightly more general than discussing only ADS4, where the computation has been done. So in this first lecture, I will discuss essentially ADSD black holes in D greater or equal than 4 that can be embedded in string theory, M theory, and so on. Okay, so they have a consistent string embedding. Tomorrow I will discuss how to construct the in field theory using localization the partition function that is supposed to count and the number of ground state of a particular class of black hole in D equal 4. And in the third lecture, I will discuss how to evaluate this partition function in the Lagrangian limit. I want to compare with supergravity using holography. So this, I will need to perform a Lagrangian limit of a partition function of a matrix model, and I'll tell you how to do that. And in the fourth lecture, but I'm not sure I will have time to go so far, I plan to discuss something, the same picture for ADS. Well, it's ADS5 black string that can be reduced to ADS4 black hole. But I cannot promise that I have time to do also this. Okay, so today we start with the gravitational description, the holographic interpretation, and essentially I want to write the object that corresponds to the entropy, and for which I need to find a field theory computation. So, as I already said, I'm interested in black holes that are asymptotically ADS and can be embedded in M theory or string theory. Actually, there are plenty of these objects that can be embedded already in a maximally supersymmetric background of M theory or string theory. So, maximally supersymmetric background relevant for holography are this one. There is an ADS4 times S7 in M theory. There is an ADS5 times S5. This is N equal 4 superior males. And there is an ADS7 times S4. This is M theory. This is type 2B. And this is M theory. And all of these are maximally supersymmetric background. And for all of this guy, we know what is the dual field theory. Well, this is the basic of the holographic correspondence. This is N equal 4 superior males. We know quite a lot also about ADS4. This is the model that I will discuss in detail. And this is the Chern-Simons theory in 3D, maximally supersymmetric. It's the ABJM theory. We will come back to this later. And even for ADS7, we know what is the theory. This is the famous so-called 2,0 theory in 6D. It's not Lagrangian, but some sense is the mother or father of all the other theories, because by compactification you can get n equal 4 and everything else. So we have a pretty well understanding of holography for this background. And there is also there are plenty of black holes in such backgrounds that are characterized by a set of charges and in general also angular momentum. So at the very beginning I will be more general, so I will consider rotating black hole. Then the main example that I will discuss is actually the one that Stefan discussed in the previous lecture, so static black hole in ADS4. But for the moment, let me be more general, because as I will tell you, there are still many open problems here, and many of these problems also involve rotation. So let me general, just to give a picture of what you would like to compute. So what kind of charge you can put? So the idea is that you want to embed the black hole in a consistent way, for example, in type 2B. So consider ADS5 times S5, for example. Here you have an isometry, which is SO2,4. S5 has an isometry, which is SO6. And here, clearly, there is a group of rotation, which is inside SO2,4. So you can introduce two spins for this guy, J1 and J2. Essentially, I'm always looking at the Cartan of these non-abelian symmetries. As Stefan discussed, there are also non-abelian versions of black hole, but they are much more complicated. So everything from now on, whenever you see a non-abelian symmetry, at a certain point, I will take the Cartan of it. Taking the Cartan of SO4 means you choose two angular momentum inside ADS5. You can choose two of them. And here, you can select a Cartan subalgebra, which is U1 to the cube, and you can put three electric charges for the Cartan generators of this U1 cube. So in general, you would expect to find a black hole that can rotate in ADS5 with two independent angular momentum, and it can rotate inside the sphere with three, if you want, these are angular momentum inside the sphere that appears as an electric charge for your black hole. Curiously, supersymmetry imposes a constraint among these guys. So in principle, you have five parameters, but the BPS conditions tell you that there are four independent ones, because there is a constraint. This has been a long time puzzle. People ask why there should be a constraint. When I will discuss the interpretation, I will interpret the microstate of this black hole as states in n equal 4 superior mills with particular spin and particular charges. And in n equal 4 superior mills, there is no such a constraint. You can construct many states that are supersymmetric with the spin that you choose, the charge that you choose. So this is a long-standing, say, puzzle, why the black hole exists only for a constraint among the charges. There is a recent paper by Santos and Markiewicz this June where they say that they found a new black hole corresponding to the missing charge. I don't know yet exactly what is the status. This black hole seems to have some mild type of singularity, tidal force, and this kind of thing. So it's not clear. Maybe there is even a full family, depending on all parameters. But for the moment, let's keep the standard law. There is a constraint among charges. Okay, in this game, actually, ADS4 is special, because here you can have dionic black holes. Let's consider the same set of charges for ADS4 times S7. Oops. Here the relevant group is SO2,3 for ADS4, is SO8 for S7. So this time you just have one possible spin that you can introduce in ADS4. So you can have the spin for your black hole. And here you can break to the Cartan SO8, and you have four charges. So for sure, you can put four electric charges. But also, since you are in four dimension, as Stefan explained, you can also have magnetic charges. So here, the number of charges that you can put is much bigger. Even in this case, actually, supersymmetry tells you that there are constraints. And essentially, as we will see better later in this lecture, there are two constraints. One is a sort of linear constraint of the magnetic charges that will be very important as related to the topological twist of the dual conformal field theory. And again, BPS tells you that there is an extra constraint among the spin and the electric charges. I will come back to this constraint later. Now, and you can play the same game here. Here you have three rotation and two electric charges, okay? No magnetic charges. Magnetic charges are relevant in four dimensions, where you can have the ionic object. Now, why I'm stressing the magnetic charges? Because the magnetic charges makes a big difference in the holographic interpretation of the black hole. Now, given your black hole, let's consider the effective field theory that you have in ADSD. So you start with ADSD times sphere, you dimensionally reduce. In many cases, all these black holes that have been found actually have been found in the lower dimensional theory and then uplifted. So you may think that this effective theory in ADSD is some gauge supergravity, or in n equal to 2 gauge supergravity as discussed by Stefan, or something more complicated, some consistent truncation of your string or M-theory background. But in general, for what I'm going to discuss is not even necessary. So suppose that you just truncate an effective theory, the effective theory lives in ADSD, you want to use holography. So in ADSD, you will have a very complicated Lagrangian. The relevant terms that are of interest are obviously the kinetic term for gravity and kinetic term for a set of gauge fields, as we saw in Stefan's lectures. Typically, in these theories, you also have scalar fields and fermions and other stuff, okay? Many other objects, in particular scalar fields. And typically, the kinetic term for the gauge field is a complicated function of the scalar fields that you need to specify. What are the scalar fields of interest? Here, these vector fields, f mu nu lambda, the one that are interested for this discussion are those that are related to the isometries of the internal manifold. So suppose that this is ADS4 times S7. You have for sure a full set of SO8 gauge field in the bulk. If you're just interested in the Cartan, you take four abelian vector that you write here, okay? This f mu nu lambda correspond to the massless guy that you find in your Lagrangian. They correspond to the isometry of the internal manifold, okay? So they correspond typically to the R-symmetry of the theory. If this, the reduction is ADS5, in principle you have an SO6 bunch of gauge field. If the theory is ADS4 times S7, you have an SO8, and so on. I will always break to the Cartan. Now I want to use holography to interpret the black holes. According to the rules of holography, a gauge field in the bulk corresponds to a global symmetry in the boundary. So gauge field in the bulk are global symmetry on the boundary. Okay? Again, example, in this case, the global symmetry is the R symmetry of the dual field theory. So the black holes that that you want to write, and Stefan wrote explicit examples, are asymptotic to ADSD. So this means that there is some radial coordinate R such that the metric for large R is of this form. There is a term dr square over r square, and in my choice of coordinates, there is an r square times md minus 1 square. So this is a standard form for a spacetime that is asymptotic to ADS. There are corrections here in 1 over r, in 1 over r, when r is not strictly infinity. And here, this guy here is just the boundary of your ADS space. And so whenever you write black holes, you typically are working in sort of global coordinates for ADS. So Stefan wrote a matrix for the black hole where this boundary term contains time and contains this, the metric on a two-sphere, okay? Which means that they are using as coordinates two angles, theta and phi, time, and the radial coordinate. There is a parameterization of ADS, which is called the global coordinates in ADS, that precisely write ADS in this form. So in general, in all the example that I'm interested in, obviously there is time. And so one component, one element of this manifold d minus 1 will be time. And in most of the black hole, the remaining coordinates parameterize a sphere. So for example, these are the coordinates theta 5 of the previous lectures. Or in three dimension, you have coordinates on a trisphere and so on. So most of the time, the boundary metric is time, time a sphere of dimension d minus 2. And this is the case I will discuss most because it's simple. Looking at sphere is simpler than looking at more general object. But in principle, you can also construct more exotic black hole if you want, where you just replace this with another manifold. Typical example, this I will discuss in detail, is ADS4. In ADS4, you have the radial coordinate, you have time. Here you have a sphere. Well, what you can do very easily is to replace the sphere with an arbitrary Riemann surface. There is nothing essentially that changed in the black hole. I don't know if you want to still call it a black hole. It has an horizon that is not a sphere, is a torus or is a Riemann surface. This object can be constructed. And from the point of view of holography and from the point of view of localization, there is not much difference between the two classes. So I will discuss the general case. So it's up to you if you like black hole with, say, hyperbolic horizon. Hyperbolic means that you take a Riemann surface or Higer genus taught as the hyperbolic plane with a quotient, okay? So, and in general, if you go to higher dimension, you can replace these guys with other stuff, okay? If you like exotic black hole. So, The first message is the following. Whenever you see a metric in the bulk that is asymptotic, that has an asymptotic of this form, well, what you are doing is the following. Since this is an effective theory in empty de Sitter D, you assume that there is a conformal field theory somewhere, conformal field theory with one dimension less, D minus one, this is holography. In a sense, the conformal field theory lives on the boundary. In standard application, in the original application of holography, one was considering the metric of ADS, and this is really either flat space in Poincaré coordinates or time sphere in global coordinates. So the logic is that when you replace this slice here with something more general, you're just taking your conformal field theory in dimension D minus one and you put the conformal field theory on this manifold, okay? Which can be a curved manifold. But we learn in the lecture by Francesco that it's not a problem, not even for supersymmetry. There are many manifolds that support supersymmetry. So we know how to do that. So this is the first message. The black hole that I will consider correspond to conformal field theory on manifold of this form, where there is a time direction, and typically there is a sphere or some other manifold. But this is not the end of the story. This is the simplest part. The point is that since there are gauge fields, and we saw that you need gauge fields to give charges and have regular black hole, in the bulk, also the gauge fields have, in general, a profile. So what you discover is that in the various examples, the profile is slightly different, but there will be a profile of the gauge field that near the boundary is some power of R that you need to specify times, in principle, a non-zero function of the coordinates on the boundary manifold. Now, so what is the interpretation of this gauge field in holography? Now, let me remind you another general paradigm of holography. Recall that. Subscript of the it's mu, sorry. Well, let's write as a form, okay? If you want, I put it here. It's a gauge field, okay? Recall that whenever you have a field in ADSD, which I write as a function of the coordinates on this manifold, D minus one and the radial coordinate. And this field has an expansion near the boundary in powers of R. So here there are some coefficients that you need to compute, and they are typically related to the conformal dimension of your field. Since generically all the fields satisfy second order equation of motion, you can always find an asymptotic solution with two independent parts. And typically the point is that one of the two in a generic situation is a non-normalizable deformation of ADS. So the norm of this phi naught is infinite if you compute the natural norm in ADS, while the second one is normalizable. This is the generic situation. Then there are caveats for the particular value of the conformal dimension, but don't go in this detail. In general, you can split phi into pieces, and the interpretation of the two pieces is different. The interpretation of the non-normalizable mode is non-normalizable, so it's doing something severe at the boundary on your conformal field theory. And what it's doing is, this guy, if you have a profile for fields in the bulk where this guy is different from zero, what you are doing is deforming your conformal field theory. How you deform your conformal field theory? Well, this field in NT the sitter is dual to some operator on the boundary, and the deformation is simply you take your conformal field theory and you add to your Lagrangian the guy that you see here, suppose that this is a constant at the boundary, but it's not necessary. So you take this guy here, you multiply by the conformal operator, and you deform in this way the conformal field theory. In general, if you have a non-normalizable deformation, you are deforming the conformal field theory using the conformal operator associated with the fields. What about the normalizable? Well, the other paradigm of holography is that instead, this guy is a source for the operator. So when you turn it on, you turn on the operator, the subleading term, the normalizable one, is not a source, but is a vacuum expectation value. So the interpretation of this second object is essentially a VEV for the operator associated to O. So whenever you have a solution that is only asymptotically ADS, and you have fields that runs, you can have an interpretation of what's going on in the dual conformal field theory in this way. You look at the field, you check if there is a non-zero, non-normalizable term, and then you say, okay, you are deforming your theory in a particular way. You are adding the operator that is associated with the guy phi. So in this case, you are doing a deformation. In this case, if this is different from zero, you can even ignore the second one. If there is a second one, that will tell you that there is also some VEV, but typically if you start deforming your conformal field theory, you will get VEV for the operators and everything else. So the other relevant situation is the situation where the guy is zero. If the guy is zero, so if there is no leading term, then there is only this one. So what's the interpretation? You are not deforming your conformal field theory. You are just studying your conformal field theory in a different vacuum. So you take the conformal field theory and you look at a situation where the operator has a VEV. So for example, in N equal 4 superior Mills, obvious VEV that you can give is to go along the Coulomb branch. You take the scalar fields in N equal 4, you give a VEV, and you may want to study your theory in this new vacuum, okay? So this is the general paradigm. No, typically the VEV then is determined by equation of by regularity in the bulk as a function of phi naught. So you will find, well, typically when you deform a theory, if you compute the vacuum expectation value of O is no more zero, it's something which is determined by the deformation, okay? So in essentially there is always some VEV, but the main deformation that you are doing is by adding terms in the Lagrange. So this is the general paradigm that you find on, first pages of any ADS CFT review. Now I want to interpret the black hole in this language. So the R-gauge field, at least, there might be other stuff, scalars and other stuff. But in general, there is gauge fields because you need charges. Then what is the interpretation? So here is the crucial point, and the difference between magnetically charged and electrically charged black hole. So let's distinguish the two cases. So for an electrically charged black hole, in all the cases that I discussed, ADS4, ADS5, ADS7, typically A mu lambda fall off at the boundary as a normalizable solution. So the term phi naught is strictly zero, okay? The leading term is strictly zero. The same is true for spin and rotation. Rotation you cannot interpret as a gauge field. Rotation is sitting here in your metric. Your metric, instead of being dt, is dt plus something generically. So you still are you are deforming your solution with terms that belong to the metric instead of the gauge field. Same question, you look at the terms in the metric, you see how they goes at the boundary, and you still discover that they goes as normalizable modes. So electrically charged and spin correspond to normalizable deformation of your boundary theory. So they correspond essentially to vacuum expectation value. So if you want to study a black hole which is electrically charged and rotates, what you have to do is just to take your conformal field theory in D minus 1, put it on the curve manifold. In the simplest case, it's just times a sphere. So you just put you do in conformal field theory radial. You go on the sphere times time, so you do radial quantization. So that's a pretty standard way of studying the conformal field theory. But you need to study the conformal field theory in a state with a non-zero expectation value for what? Well, the operator dual to the gauge field is essentially the current. So essentially, you are studying your conformal field theory in a state with non-zero charge. Yes?
Doesn't it happen that you have to require regularity at the horizon and you get a non-normalizable piece, the chemical potential for the gauge field?
So the chemical potential would be the non-normalizable piece. But if you look at the black hole when you fix the charges, so it depends on the choice of ensemble. So the black hole, you can fix charges or chemical potential. If you fix the charges, that's the behavior of your gauge field is such that it's normalizable at the boundary. Okay. So what's the interpretation? Well, you're studying your conformal field theory in a sector where the electric charges and the spin, let me call it J, I hope there is no confusion with J mu, which is the current associated to.
And you're holding the chemical potential fixed, so that the expectation value of Q is.
So
Q has an expectation value.
Q has an expectation value, yes. So you are just studying the conformal field theory in a sector where the electric charge is different from zero and the spin is different from zero. What's the meaning? Well, I want to know what happens to the conformal field theory in a state with given electric charge and given angular momentum. This is a black hole, should correspond to an ensemble of states. And if you are after the microstate, you say, OK, what are the microstates? Well, the microstates of this black hole should be just a set of spinful and charge states in the conformal field theory. What spin and what charge? Well, this is specified by the spin and the charge of the black hole. So if you want to study the entropy of the black hole, you just need to count the number of states that have a given spin and a given charge. Okay, that's simple enough and pretty natural. This is for electrically charged black hole. If you add magnetic charge, and to add magnetic charge, you need to be in ADS4, well, you discover that the magnetic charge in 4D behaves quite differently. So if you look at the profile of the gauge field in the bulk, you discover that the profile of the gauge field in the bulk for large R is not a normalizable solution. In this case, A mu lambda behaves as a non-normalizable solution. I can even write for you because Stefano already did. The point is the following. Suppose that you have a black hole in ADS4 with a spherical horizon. So your boundary, what I call M3, is just in Lorentzian signature, just time times S2. And the point is that, as we learn in Stefan lectures, there is a magnetic charge, which means that you have a gauge field, F, such that if you integrate over the sphere, you get a number. Actually, because of quantization in suitable units, if you take this integral and divide by 2 pi, you should get some integer. This is just the Dirac quantization condition that Stefan mentioned. And this is should be true at all possible value of the radial coordinates, in particular at the boundary, at r equal infinity. So if you want to write explicitly the gauge field, well, you can. For a sphere, it's very simple. Just a monopole, OK? You see that there is no dependence on r here, which means that the guy survives all the way to the boundary. It's there. You can compute the norm in IDS. The norm is infinite. So this is a non-normalizable deformation of ADS. Or you can easily generalize this to a Riemann surface. Cannot write for you. I don't know how to write it. Well, I know. I need to choose coordinates on the Riemann surface, but it will take longer. It's not important. You can replace the monopole with the natural object with magnetic charge on the Riemann surface. There is the analogs of the monopole. I will call it monopole from now on. There is a monopole on the Riemann surface, and again, the charge is quantized. So what's happened to the dual field theory? As I told you, this is non-normalized, so you are changing the conformal field theory. How? Well, the first thing that you do is to add the background field, A mu, A lambda mu, what is the natural deformation? Well, obviously, from the point of view of holography, every gauge field is associated with a current for a global symmetry. So what you are doing is turning on a standard gauge coupling between this guy, which is a global symmetry, and what you are doing is turning on a background gauge field for some global symmetry. This you can do in field theory, which simply means that you deform your Lagrange by adding the current multiplied by the background gauge field. So the point that these black holes have a different interpretation. They are interpreted as a deformation of the conformal field theory, where you put background gauge fields for the various global symmetries. To understand better what's going on, it's useful to look at how supersymmetry is preserved. So remember that there is always this guy here, essentially a monopole that you turn on. If you look at how supersymmetry is preserved, you need to look at the variation of the gravitino. Stefan wrote it for us. And schematically, my notation obviously are not precisely the same as those of Stefan, but you can easily make a dictionary. Well, obviously, there is the spin connection here. And in, as he may discuss carefully, in gauge supergravity, the guy is charged under a collection of fields. So there is an R symmetry, graviphoton, that you are gauging. And quite schematically, let me call it in this way. Should put an I here. So this is the variation of the gravitino. So what happens, as also Francesco was discussing this morning, if we are in ADS4, so the boundary is time times S2. Time is pretty boring. Let's take everything constant on time, OK? It's a flat space. It's not interesting. S2 is curved. And you need to have some BPS equation that tells you how supersymmetry is preserved. But the spin connection on S2, or even on a Riemann surface, is just an abelian gauge field. Here you have an abelian gauge field. So if you turn on an abelian gauge field that cancels the spin connection, well, your equation of supersymmetry can be solved very pretty easy in this way. You choose a constant spin. I'm cheating a little bit because I started with rotating black hole. So for rotating black hole, it's a mess. So for static one, this is the relevant equation that you have to write. But even for rotating, there is a generalization with things. But let's focus on the static case. So essentially the point is that on the sphere, the spin connection, you can do your computation by yourself, compute the spin connection on the two sphere, you will find a very simple expression. The simple expression is will tell you that the spin connection on the sphere is just a unit monopole. It's a sphere, it's precisely of the same form. If you write it as a form, tomorrow we write it better, the spin connection is exactly cos theta d phi. So it can be canceled by the background that you turn on. And it is indeed canceled. So, yes?
Can I now think of the CFT on S2 as being an almost two-dimensional CFT?
Yes, but it is on the sphere. And now I'm coming to this point.
Would it have an infinite dimensional complement symmetry like Virasoro or super
Virasoro? Yes, but I want to deform it with this gauge field. So what you get, and what I was saying right now, is that what you are doing is a topological twist of this theory. Indeed, as you saw, and we will come back tomorrow to this point in details, as you saw in Francesco's lecture, this is one of the way of preserving supersymmetry on the sphere. And as he mentioned, it's very old, correspond to a topological twist. Tomorrow we will discuss precisely the meaning in all details, but if you remember the whole story about the topological twist as introduced by Witten, was just a change in the nature of fermions, so was mixing the Lorentz group with some R symmetry, and mixing the Lorentz group with some R symmetry in this more perhaps transparent terms means turn on the background field for some R symmetry in such a way that cancel the spin connection, so that the equation that you typically cannot solve on a sphere, you can solve in a sphere, but you get complicated objects. The covariant derivative in the presence of this guy becomes just a standard derivative, and you solve you preserve supersymmetry by taking a constant spin. Or you do what you typically do in flat space, essentially. So this is the topological twist. So the meaning of the interpretation of this black hole is that you're doing a topological twist. Actually, this guy here, you may have many gauge fields in the bulk, as Stefan was discussing. This is a particular combination, the one that he called zeta lambda A lambda mu before. So there is a particular combination of your gauge field that enters here. And you need supersymmetry tells you, well, you should better choose the right charge for this particular combination in such a way that it cancels the spin connection. Then you may also have other global symmetries once the R symmetry is fixed. All of them have this profile, this monopole profile. So coming back to the interpretation of a magnetically charged black hole, is essentially now the interpretation is the following. You are taking your conformal field theory, you are deforming in this way. This is just another way of saying that you are doing a topological twist in the sense of Witten. So the magnetic charge corresponds to a topological twist. They are deforming your theory. And what about the rest? If you have electric charges, rotation, well, they behave precisely as before. So the interpretation of a magnetically charged black hole with electric and charge and spin is the following. You take your conformal field theory, you deform it according to the magnetic charges, and then you start count. You count the number of states that have a given electric charge and a given spin. So you always have a counting problem, counting the number of states with given electric charge and given angular momentum. But in the case of this black hole, you just count on the conformal field theory. When you have magnetic charges, you count the same states in the topologically twisted version of the theory. We will see that topological twist helps with the computation because it gives you a computation that you can match with holography. Let me also mention that, again, for the differences between this black hole, here the spin is constant, very simple. And here is a mess, especially when there is rotation. You need to, I couldn't even find for this, the famous class of black hole Gutowski real. It's very difficult to find explicit expression for, there are in the literature. But it's a mess, typically, okay? So. Oh, typically the scalar, there are some of them that are just partner under supersymmetry of what I'm doing here. So typically, in the example that I will discuss, there are running scalars. So they also induce some small deformation, but the deformation that they induce is just the supersymmetry partner of this, okay? Then you can have more general black hole with hypers. That's more complicated things that you have to do. The one idea of the, well, this idea of localization, as Francesco was discussing, is that you can compute something, but integral or correlation function of certain specific operator, okay? Yes, it's true in a sense, but you need to, this is a full quantum field theory on S2, so there are excitations that are not topological. The only point is that I cannot compute those using localization. And I will not need to compute those, okay? All what I will need is the partition function that I can compute. Now, so let me summarize what you, again, what you have to do. Enumerate all the states with electric charge, let's call it QI, and spin that can be more than one, so let me call JI, the spin, in the conformal field theory on R times S d minus 2 for electrically charged and rotating black hole. That's what you have to do. Or in the topologically twisted CFT on R times SD minus 2 for magnetically charged black hole. Okay? So the magnetic charges enter here in the topological twist. Now, enumerating states is equivalent, well, this is the way we like to package things in statistical mechanics or in string theory, is equivalent to knowing some partition function, particularly some, I will introduce some grand canonical partition function. So I will introduce chemical potentials for the electric charges and the spin. And I can package the information that I want . This is the number of states with charge QI, charges QI, and spins JK. This is what I want to compute. I claim that essentially the term is the entropy of the black hole, is the number of microstates. I can just package this by summing over all the charges and the spins with chemical potentials. I call delta the chemical potential for the electric charge, and omega the chemical potential for the spin. And I can write a generating function for this object. This obviously can be also written as a trace. If you introduce operators that correspond to these conserved quantities, let's call this operator RI, so the charge operator, and let's call, I'm over with letter, let's call J tilde with some funny notation, the operator whose eigenvalue is jk. This is simply computing a trace on the Hilbert space of I delta I, the corresponding charge, plus omega k, the spin operator. So these are the operators in your conformal field theory. Oh, something that I should mention, I probably was not very precise here. You count all the states, but you don't want really all the states. You want all the states that preserve the same supersymmetries of the black hole. So I restrict this sum here to the supersymmetric states. Those that preserve the same supersymmetry of the black hole. Now, what? Oh, the other states probably will contribute to the entropy of some non-supersymmetric black hole, extremal non-supersymmetric black hole, okay? The microstate of this one should satisfy the same supersymmetric constraint as the black hole. So this is what you would like to know, and then the entropy of the black hole is just hidden in this coefficient here. So if you know the partition function, the coefficients are easily found by Fourier transform, Legendre transform, whatever, depends where you integrate, where you put your contour, depends on. But essentially what you can do is some integral to extract the coefficient. If I put an I here, I put a minus I here, delta I qi plus omega k jk. And so that's a, if you really know this partition function for all value of delta and omega, you can compute the number of states. Number of states is the exponential of the entropy of your system. So this guy here, you want to identify with the black hole entropy. So this is basically what you have to do. In all cases, even probably in Samir lecture, it's always the same structure. The goal is to compute this one, the generating function of all entropy for all black hole. Now, I will be discussing holography where there is a large parameter, is large n. So essentially, these guys here will be large. So in that case, I can evaluate the integral by saddle point approximation, okay? So I will be always in the case where you can use saddle point. Saddle point, you know it works, you exponentiate this, and you take the mean, the extremum of the exponent. And the extremum of exponent give you the value in this large n limit of this quantity. So in the limit where the charges are large, or n is large, when you can use gravity, essentially, what you have to compute is the following. Delta I qi, omega k jk, evaluated on the extremum of this quantity. So you determine the quantity such that the derivative with respect to delta and omega of this quantity here, log of z minus I, delta I qi plus omega k jk is zero, okay? This, as you know, is also called the Legendre transform. It's something that you do every day in statistical mechanics, where indeed you take the thermodynamical limit, which is an analogous of the saddle point here. And this is telling you that in this limit, the entropy is the Legendre transform of your partition function, quite natural, okay? That's statistical mechanics. So the point is, how can I compute this object here? Can I do that? Well, the main message is that, okay, it's hard because It's not always you can enumerate all the states in a conformal field theory with a given charge and a given supersymmetry. You can do sometimes. For example, in n equal 4 superior males, if I ask, can I enumerate all the 1/2 BPS states with a given electric charge? Yes, it's a pretty simple problem I could solve for you in 10 minutes. Very simple. Complex geometry and nothing more. 1/2 BPS. But if you remember, the black hole that I'm interested in are 1/4 BPS. The problem of enumerating all the 1/4 BPS states in n equal 4 superior mean is open. People tried 10 years ago, very hard. They couldn't find any solution for the problem. There are partial results. So this is too hard to compute. Then what I can do? Well, I can hope to be lucky and compute something else, hoping that it gives the same result. The something else that I will compute for you in this series of lecture is the supersymmetric partition function. What's the difference? When it's written in terms of a trace of an Hilbert space, the main difference is that instead of being a trace, it's an index. So there is a minus 1 to the f that counts in a different way bosons and fermions. Clearly, it's not the same object. This is an index because you can, for free, introduce your Hamiltonian here with a parameter which is a fictitious temperature. There's no temperature in this black hole. There are BPS. And indeed, there is no dependence on this beta. And the reason is the old Witten index idea. So whenever you have supersymmetry, the states that have non-zero value of the energy are paired for every boson. There is a fermion. You apply supersymmetry. They have the same energy. Since they have the same charge, because charge commute with the Hamiltonian. So in this sum, all the massive states cancel. And you are left with just the states with zero energy, which is precisely this sum here. And as you know from textbook, whenever you have a trace over e to the minus beta h, you can rewrite as a path integral. Path integral on what? Well, the path integral is the path integral on the manifold that I discussed before. Actually, in order to interpret this as a path integral, you need to go to the Euclidean. So what you do when you have finite temperature is to take your time direction, compactify on a circle of radius beta. So you make a circle of radius beta. You integrate on the manifold. So in all the cases that I already had a compact manifold, I add a circle. The radius of the circle will be relevant because the partition function is supersymmetric. It's not actually depending on this beta, but you can formally introduce it. And this is the partition function with some chemical potential turn on of your conformal field theory. So this is the object that I can compute. And in general, this is different from this one, OK? Because one counts all the states. The other counts all the states with a sign, all the ground state, but with a sign, plus if they are boson, and minus if they are fermions. So if you're lucky, and many times this happens in string theory, you're lucky, there are no cancellations in the sense that the majority of your states in the Lagrangian limit are either bosonic or fermionic. If this is the case, well, the physical content of the two partition function is in the Lagrangian limit is the same. And I will show you that for ADS4 black hole, indeed, there is such large cancellation of between both. There is no large cancellation between bosons and fermions. So the majority of states are all bosonic or fermionic. And this partition function correctly reproduce the entropy of the black hole. Now, this will work for ADS4. As I will mention at a certain point, if you try to do the same trick for ADS5, this was done more than 10 years ago, you fail miserably. For the same partition function, instead, there is a large cancellation between states. This guy is different from this. You have to explain an entropy that goes like n squared in field theory. You find a number that goes like 1. Cannot explain the entropy. okay? For some reason, in ADS4, with the topological twist, remember that the main difference is the magnetic charge, the topological twist is such that... it's over? Okay. No, no, I can stop here.
We are getting there.
Getting there or over?
Almost there. Well, it's time.
It's time. Okay, good. Okay. So this is the object that I will start evaluating for you tomorrow morning. Actually, I will spend the first 10 minutes in telling you precisely the form of the black hole I'm interested in. We luckily already had Stefan lecture, and he covered most of the topics, so that part will be quick. And after that, we will start computing for ADS4, this supersymmetric partition function. So the point is that I will take a conformal field theory, I'll tell you how to implement the topological twist, and how to evaluate explicitly the partition function.